Done is what the apostle said he had done, whether it be good or bad. Knowing therefore the terror of the Lord, we must persuade men, but we are made manifest unto God, and I trust also are made manifest in your presence. So the fear of the Lord. Knowing therefore the terror of the Lord. This kind of attitude always often lacking in the ministry. No? Many Christians are not taking the things of God seriously. So, okay, we are working in the ministry, but we are working because it's just an obligation, or it's just we want somebody to show us that we are working in the ministry. So we're not taking it seriously. No? So we must fear God. We must fear God.
Amen.
And it's motivate us to work in this ministry, to continue in ministry. And who is our Lord? Our Lord is the creator of heaven and earth. He is a God. He is the author of our salvation. And he is the judge.
Amen.
So we must work for the Lord. We must fear the Lord. So it's time for the believer to have a revival as far as appealing to God is concerned. You can see in Ecclesiastes chapter 12, verse 13 and 14. Let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter. Fear God and keep his commandments. For this is the whole duty of man. For God shall bring every work into judgment with every secret thing, whether it be good or whether it be evil. So we will accountable so for whatever we are doing here and there. No? So we will face God. So we will face God when we go to heaven, when we finish on this world, no? When the Lord comes, then we will look face to face our God. But the question is, can we face to Him? Can we look to Him straightly? So it's stated there that every work into judgment with secret things, whether it be good or whether it be evil. We should fear God. And also in Job 31:23, for destruction from God was a terror to me, and by reason of his highness I could not endure. And also in Hebrews 10:31, it is a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. Paul explained his motive by sharing his own testimony. So we can see Paul, no? We know Paul that he is a persecutor of the church before. But he made motivate to persecute the church and during the time just to eliminate this Christian, not to spread the gospel. But God saved him and now he is a servant of God. And Paul continued to work in the ministry of God, and something is motivating him to continue the work of God. So Paul explained his motive by sharing his own testimony in this on three powerful statements. This should also serve as a motive for every Christian. First, we labor. First, we labor. This means we are ambitious. Paul's ambitious is to be well-pleasing to the Lord Jesus Christ. So what do you mean by labor? Labor is a physical and mental effort. No? He gave himself to the ministry of God. So not only physical, but also mental and also is spiritual. So I minister to please God, our Lord alone. No, he's working for the Lord, not to any man. Before, he's working for the man. That's why he's persecuting this Christian, because he's working for men, but now he's working for God.
Amen.
Working for our Lord. So, he wants to please our God.
No.
And to please our God, we please our God when we present our bodies to Him. In Romans 12:1, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. Present your God. Present your body to God. No? It should be pleased on our body, because this is our, this is a temple of God. He is living in our body. No? This, so we must be holy to Him. Also, He is pleased to us when we help others.
In
Romans 14:18, for He had in these things served Christ is acceptable to God and approved unto men. So we should help others. No? We're helping ourselves, but we need to help others, especially the people who are in need. First, there is spiritual condition, and second, their physical needs. No? As a Christian, we must need to help others. Also, God, please ask if we separate from evil. We must separate from evil things. No? Because we are living in this world and a lot of temptation. So people are there, our friend, our family also, which is not a Christian, sometimes they pulling us to the evil things, and some they tempted us to do sin. So we should separate from their evil things. No, we'll not separate to them, but we will separate from the evil things. No? So how can we win them if we will separate from them? We must be with them to teach them and to share the word of God. But from the evil things, we should be separated to them.
Amen.
Also, God pleases to us when we bring our offering to Him.
Amen.
When we bring our offering to Him. What is our offering? Or tithes and offering, money, not only money, ourselves.
Yeah.
Not ourselves, not our time, our talent. So we must bring to Him. We must offer to Him. And first, Philippians 4:18, but I have all and abound, I am full and have received of Epaphroditus the things which were sent from you, and an odor of sweet smell and sacrifice acceptable, well pleasing to God. So we must please God when we present our body, when we are helping others, when we separate from evil, and we bring our offering to Him. The other things, God listens to us when the children submit to their parents. Colossians 3:20, children, obey your parents in all things, for this is the well-pleasing unto the Lord. Nowadays, the popular quote of the children is, what is that popular quote? When the parents ask to them something, what they will say? Wait. So wait. Wait lang po. Kahit yun na po. Wait lang po. Nag-text pa o may nagsinapanood. So the children should submit to their parents. No? They should submit to their parents.
Amen.
Because your parents is experienced what he had before when he's a child, so he is imparting it to us, no, to the children. So sometimes the children didn't understand it until they have their family. They should submit to their parents, no? Because this is the commandments of God. And also, God blesses us when we permit Him to work out of His perfect will in our lives. In Hebrews chapter 13, verse 20 and 21, so the God of peace that brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you perfect in every good works to do His will, working in you that is well-pleasing in His sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. So we must permit to work out His perfect will in our lives. So what is His will? First, His will is to save us to work in His ministry. No? To work in ministry. So we must always depend on His will, not on our will. Don't insist your will. Just wait for the will of God. No? If we insist our will, then it will be a problem later. So just let God work to you. No? Obey His will. In second point, false testimony is we must all appear. We must all appear in verse 10, for we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that everyone may receive the things done in his body according to that he had done, whether it be good or bad. So every believer is going to appear before the Lord. And it's now time to prepare. So we will stand in the presence of the Lord.
Yes.
And this is the great white hall?
No.
That is the judgment seat of Christ.
Yes.
Great white hall is for the unsaved people, but yes, for the saved, for the believer, is the judgment seat of Christ. We will face to face our Lord. No? And so in Romans 14:8, for whether we live unto the Lord, and whether we die unto the Lord. Whether we live therefore or die, we are the Lord. For to this end Christ both died and rose and revived, that we might be the Lord both of the dead and living. Verse 10, but why dost thou judge thy brother, or why dost thou set at naught thy brother? For we shall all stand before the judgment seat of Christ. So judgment seat of Christ is for the believer.
Mm.
So a judgment seat of Christ is a place of revelation. So it's a place of revelation. In 1 Corinthians 3:13, every man's work shall make manifest, or they shall declare. So every man's work shall be made manifest. No? There will be no pretending. How can you pretend in the presence of God that you did this, you did this? But it's not true. No, everything will be manifest. Everything will be revealed to the face of God. No? So this is the place of revelation. This is the place of revelation where we can see our Lord face to face. He will reveal what all the things we have done here on earth. So it's a place of reckoning. On Romans 14, verse 10 to 12, but why the Romans 14, 10 to 12, why does that judge thy brother? Why does thou set thy note of thy brother? For we stand for shall all stand before the justice of Christ. For it is written, as I live, said the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, and everything shall confess to God. So then every one of us shall give an account of himself to God. So it is a shameful if we face our Lord that we cannot say anything what we have done here on earth. So it's very shameful. That's why I don't know if we can look face to face to our Lord. Yes, we cannot look directly to our Lord because of His glorious face. No? But how can you look to Him if you didn't do anything on here? No? So it's time to prepare for us because we must all appear to our God. Also, it's a place of rewards. It's a place of rewards.
Yeah.
According to 1 Corinthians 3:10, according to the grace God which is given unto me, as a wise master builder, I have laid the foundation and another builder thereon. But let every man take heed how he buildeth therein. For other foundation can no man lay than that is laid, which is Jesus Christ. Verse 12. Now, if any man build upon this foundation gold, silver, precious stone, wood, hay, stubble, every man's work shall be made manifest. For the day shall declare it, because it shall be revealed by fire, and fire shall try every man's work, for what sort it is. If any man works abide, which is he hath built thereon, thereupon he shall receive a reward. If any man works shall be burned, he shall suffer loss, but he himself shall be saved, yet he saw as by fire. So our work will be tested by fire. So we will see if our work is acceptable to God. If that is acceptable to God, so we have a reward.
Yeah.
We have a reward. There's a reward waiting for believer who faithfully serve to his ministry. So it's a place of revelation. It's a place of reckoning. It's a place of reward. And also this is a place of rejoicing.
Yeah.
Place of rejoicing for those a faithful servant. You know, because he will give account to our Lord. He can give a report to our Lord what he did in his ministry while he is here on earth. You know, it's a place of rejoicing. In 1 John chapter 2, verse 28. And now little children abide in him, that when we shall appear, we may have confidence and not be ashamed before him at his coming. And also in Revelation 4:10, the 24 elders shall fall down before him, that sat on the throne and worshiping, that liveth forever and ever, and cast their crowns before the throne, saying. So it's a time of rejoicing, a place of rejoicing. So they gave us a reward. They will give a crown to those a faithful servant. But as stated here on Revelation 4:10, that and cast their crowns before the throne, saying, so they will give back this crown to our Lord Jesus Christ, because he is the karapat-dapat na sa kanya lang ang lahat ng kapurihan. No? So we can receive this crown as a reward, but he can give this crown again to our Lord because he is our Lord. Siya lang ang karapat-dapat na magkaroon ng corona. So this judgment is of Christ, a place of revelation, a place of reckoning, a place of reward, and a place of rejoicing. Are you prepared for this judgment of Christ? Can you face the Lord Jesus Christ on that time? Can you give an account? Can you give a report to our Lord Jesus Christ on that time? And also, Paul's great statement is we, on third point, we persuade men. Persuade men. If we convince, we bring to men. Christ commanded us to spread the gospel to all nations, and we must be vigilant for this. For this our marching for them. Mm-hmm. So, he commanded us to spread the gospel.
Amen.
So we persuade men, we teach us to people, we bring salvation to them. No, we share the salvation. No, we will not hide it in ourselves, we will not keep it in ourselves. No, we experience the salvation, how it's give us peace. So we must share it also. No, don't be a selfish person that we will keep that salvation just only to us. We should share this salvation to others as the Lord commanded to spread the gospel.
Yeah.
So how can we prepare for the justice of Christ? How can we give accounting of ourselves to the Savior? So we must maintain a clear conscience. We must maintain a clear conscience. In 2 Corinthians 5:11, knowing therefore the terror of the Lord, we persuade man. But we are made manifest unto God. And I trust also are made manifest in your conscience. So you must always have a good conscience. Second, we must take care not to depend on the praise of men. 2 Corinthians 5:12, for we commend not ourselves again unto you, but give you occasion to glory on our behalf, that you may have someone to answer them with glory in appearance and not in heart. So we must take care not to depend on the praise of men. So we must give all the glory only to God, not to ourselves. So ignore these praises of men. No, because if we take it on our heart, then we will be proud in ourselves. But it's God who gave us the knowledge. God is giving us the strength, no, to stand, to speak to others. No. So don't depend on the praise of man. And also we must ignore criticism of men. So we must continue to work to God in the ministry, not even other people criticize us. No. 2 Corinthians 5:13, for whether we be besides ourselves, it is to God, or whether we be sober, it is for your cause. So ignore the criticism of men. So don't be sidetracked of this criticism. Don't make it yourself to go down or backslide because of this criticism. But when we first know Christ, the salvation, the first critic is our family. No? But we must continue on our faith that we receive. And someday your family also will know the faith, and they will receive also the Lord Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
So just ignore the criticism of men. Also, we must have a clean life. pure and holy. The first Peter 1:15, but as he who has called you is holy, so be ye holy in all manner of conversation. Because it is written, be ye holy, for I am holy. So we must be pure. We must have a holy life. Yes, we have still here in our physical body, but we have a Holy Spirit that dictates us, help us, and we have the Word of God that our guide for our living. So we must pure and we must have a holy life because our God is holy.
Amen.
And the last thing, we must fulfill the Great Commission.
Amen.
Matthew 28:18-20, we all know this verse. And Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world.
Amen.
So, we must fulfill that Great Commission. As Pastor preached this morning, we must personally preach the gospel, you know, with courageous, with our heart. No, we must share the gospel. We must preach the gospel. No, whatever the people say, we must continue to share the gospel, because this is the commandment of God.
Amen.
And this is a great commission that we need to fulfill. In conclusion, it behoves the duty as necessary for every Christian to examine his own life regularly. So we must examine our life, you know, to see if we are ready for his judgment, for the judgment seat of Christ. Wanting to give account before the Christ is a worthy motive for our Christian service. So we must have a correct motive in the ministry of God. We must have a right motive. So this motivation will continue us for the ministry of God until we wait for our Lord Jesus Christ. So fear the Lord.
Amen.
Because our God is a holy God. Amen. So,
thank you so much, Brother Armand. Okay, prepare your questions, okay? Prepare your questions so that we can just to make sure that we learn something. So the our lesson is motives for the ministry. Okay, what is your motive? Why do you do what you do? Why do you do what you do? Why did you come to church today? Why do you give? Why do you sing in the choir? Why do you go all the time to studies? Why do you win souls? Why do you do what you do? Always remember this. The why is just as important as the what. What you do and why you do what you do is equally important. Okay? So we may not know the motive of each one. We may not know the motive of each one. Even during the earthly ministry of the Lord, do you remember so many people following the Lord? Do you remember that incident? Go to John chapter 6. Let me show you something here. Why were people following the Lord? Do you know? Why were people following the Lord? John chapter 6. Why were they following him? Can somebody tell me?
Because they saw his miracles.
Will that be a good motive? To follow the Lord Jesus Christ and see the miracles, is that a good motive? I think it's a fair motive. Okay? will not consider it as the best motive, but you know, it's a fair motive. But can you look for the verse here when it says, you follow me, not because of the miracles? Verse number 26. Thank you so much, Brother Martin. Jesus answered them and said, verily, verily, I say to you, you seek me, you see this? Not because you saw the miracles. But what? But because you did eat of the loaves and were filled. What's that with motive? Hello? What's that with motive? That was a very selfish motive. They were just following the Lord because, you know, because of the bread, because of something they can get. You know, the ministry is not about what you can get. The ministry is about what you can give. And so, if you will look at verse number 66, the Bible says that from that time many of his disciples went back and walked no more with him. It's because they were following the Lord with the wrong motive. Okay. Now let's go back here. Brother Arman said the Christian worker must have the right motive for the ministry as well as the right message. Those are the two things that are very important. Tamang motibo at tamang mensahe. If you have the right message, but you have the wrong motive, okay, that is still not good. Okay? So those are very, very important. And the lesson today is, what is one motive for the ministry? For the ministry. What is our motive? Number one, the fear of the Lord. Okay? And Paul stated three powerful statements about his motives. Let's just simplify this one. One motive is, we do what we do to please the Lord. Did you get that? You may write that down, please. Under number one. Letter B, and then you have number one. That's the explanation of that one. We are in the ministry because we want to please the Lord. Okay? We want to please the Lord. Can you check Romans chapter 15? Romans chapter 15, the Bible says in verse number 2, or verse number 1 and 2. We then that are strong ought to bear the infirmities of the weak. That is a ministry. Helping the weak is a ministry. And not to please ourselves. Verse 2, let every one of us please his neighbor for his good edification. For even Christ pleased not himself, but this is written, reproaches of them that reproach thee fell on me. So, one motive for the ministry is what? We are in the ministry, we do what we do to what? Tell me, to? Say it louder. To? Okay. Our African brothers. We do what we do, of course, in the ministry, to what? To please the Lord, to please God. 1 Corinthians chapter 10 and verse number 30. What does the Bible say? 1 Corinthians chapter 10 and verse number 30. Okay. The Bible says, whether therefore ye eat or drink, or whatsoever you do, what? Do all to the glory of God. That's very, very clear. So let's repeat. Number one, of course, our motive is to fear the Lord, and Paul is taking three things. So under number one, or fearing the Lord, is our motive is to please the Lord. Okay? Everybody say it. Ready? Say it. To please the Lord. Number two, what we are regarding the judgment seat of Christ, kung ako kayo obligation dito. And may state something under this, Brother Martin. Because the Bible says we shall all appear. So if you connect this with your motive, what is your motive for service? In relation to the judgment seat of Christ. Brother Paul. Hindi, may idea ka. Tignan mo yan. Paano natin malaman yan kung ano? Brother Ben. Okay? In your own words, knowing that someday you will stand before the judgment seat of Christ.
We must
prepare. Okay. That's a very good to prepare for the judgment seat of Christ. I would say to give an account, to give a good account during the judgment seat of Christ. So besides serving the Lord, okay, I mean the right way to serve the Lord is to serve the Lord to please Him, and also to give a good account, or let brother, sabi ni Brother Ronald, to prepare. Pareho din to. To give a good account when we stand before the judgment seat of Christ. Remember the verse that binasa ni Brother Arman kanina. Okay? So, 1 John chapter 2 and verse number, anong verse yun? 28. Diba ito sabi, and now little children, abide in Him, that when He shall appear, we may have confidence and not be ashamed before Him at His coming. Therefore, there are two reactions when we stand before the Lord. Ano yung mga yun? Ano yung Sister Michelle? It's either you will stand before the Lord with confidence, or you will stand before the Lord what? Ashamed or embarrassed. See? That's why if we serve the Lord now with the right motive, someday when we stand before the Lord, we can give a good account. Okay? Because we will be judged someday. And we, nabanggit ni Brother Arman yung mga, yung reward natin dyan. Number three, not only to please the Lord and to give a good account, what else? Number three, ano yung lesson niya dyan? Why do we persuade men? Why? Why do you go for soul winning? Why do you tell people about the Lord? Why?
Because of Christ.
Brother David?
Because of Christ.
Because of?
Christ.
Okay. Brother Chris? Why do we persuade men? Okay, that's a very good answer. Because it's a command. What else? Brother Mark, bakit tayo ng soul winning? Bakit? Anong pinaka-purpose dito?
Because of hell.
Because of hell, that's a very good reason. Okay. What else? Sister John, you're saying something?
To spread the gospel.
To spread the gospel? Yun nga. But why do we spread the gospel?
Love God.
Sister Precious? Okay. Very good.
We are obeying.
Huh?
Obeying.
To obey? Lahat na yata nasabi, Brother Richard?
Because this is the time that you can.
Because this is the time that you can. What else? Brother Iboy?
We love God.
We love God. What else? It was commanded by the Lord? Okay. Good. Don't we tell people about the Lord so that they will be saved? Okay. And by the way, all the answers are okay. I'm just giving you, those are your lessons and this is my lesson. So, basing from the three powerful statements that the Apostle Paul made, we learn three things. He did what he did. Now, yung kanyang motive, one is to please the Lord, second is to give a good account when you stand before the Lord and for the judgment seat of Christ, and number three is for the salvation of souls, for souls to be saved. So, these are very good lessons here. And in the end, yung number three, we must fulfill the Great Commission na nakalagay na. Let me just read to you a few more verses and we are done. Go back to the book of Matthew. You heard me say this before. This is for the sake of the new ones in our church. Balikan natin yung Matthew chapter 26 and then Matthew 28. And then we will run off things. Matthew 26 verse number 32. This is before the Lord Jesus Christ died. Ano sabi niya sa mga disciples? What did He tell His disciples? Matthew 26:32, He said, but after I am risen again, I will go before you into what's the place?
Galilee.
Okay. 28. Let's go to chapter 28. When the ladies came to the tomb very early Sunday morning to anoint the body of the Lord Jesus Christ, He was no longer in the tomb. Verse 6. He is not here, for He is risen. And He said, come see the place where the Lord lay. Go quickly and tell His disciples that He is risen from the dead, and behold, He goeth before you into. Now, what is very significant about this place? Why Galilee? Before he died, he said, I will go before you into Galilee. Now that he is risen, the angel said, okay, you go to his disciples to go and meet him in Galilee. What's so important in Galilee? Ano meron doon? Okay. Now look at verse number 10. As they were going to tell his disciples, in verse number 9, Jesus met them saying, all hail, and they came and held him by the feet and worshipped him. And Jesus said unto them, be not afraid, go tell my brethren that they go into. That's the third time. Something special is taking place in Galilee. What is that? Okay. Verse number 16. Then the 11 disciples went into Galilee. That's the fourth time already. What took place in Galilee? Into a mountain where Jesus had appointed them, and when they saw him, they worshipped him. But some doubted. And Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, this is it now. All power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you all the way, even unto the end of the world. Ito para yung importanteng mangyayari sa Galilee. It was in Galilee where the Great Commission was given. You know, just the Lord Jesus Christ and His disciples. There were probably other people na nandun during the time, if you will study this context. But the Lord gave us the Great Commission here. So, these are the motives for the ministry. If you are serving the Lord, I hope that this will be your motive. You do what you do for the Lord. Whatever you do it to please the Lord. You do it so that you will have good, you will be, so that you will have a good, you can give a good account to the Lord when you stand before the judgment seat of Christ, and you do what you do for the salvation of the lost souls. So those are the three things that we can learn from this lesson. We will continue this next time. Do you have any questions? Okay, any questions? Okay. Any questions? When you don't ask questions, that only means one thing. You're saying, I want to go home now. No, gets people said? Yeah. Okay, that's great. That's great. Okay, so we let's pray. We will ask Brother Nico, you come and you pray for the offering. You come and pray for the offering. This is our half the needy offering. We need to help Brother Stephen Sam, and you know we also receive a call from the embassy. I don't know if Brother Sister Martha, do you know if Brother Samuel was able to contact Kevin? Somebody, Kevin, the Kenya embassy called us and said that there is a lady whose mom died and she needs to go tomorrow Saturday. And okay. They called us and they are asking for help from our church if we could assist that lady with her some of her faith. They have some money but not enough. So let's give to help those who are in need. And during the offering, we will ask Brother Bob to come and lead us in our closing song.
Let's go to as we have learned that we should have the right motive in serving the Lord. Lord, as we give for those who are in need, Lord, we pray that our motives will be correct. We give you bless and give them the giver for this is my prayer in the most precious name of my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen.
For our closing.